are. Thank you, Amy. So I just want to welcome you. I want to let you know, a really great speaker, a friend of FMBR, and I know you're all anxious to hear him, so without further ado, please welcome Rollin McCraty.
Great, welcome. Thanks for coming. I'm surprised to see so many people here. I was asked to talk a little bit about the workshop tomorrow, so let me get that out of the way. Tonight I'm going to be talking about, which we look at as a special project of the HeartMath Institute, which is the nonprofit side of HeartMath. So I'm going to be really focused on that. And this is really going to be about the interconnection between humanity and the Earth itself. So tomorrow's workshop is very different. It's going to be really more about what HeartMath is about, the tools, techniques, the heart-brain interaction, heart rate variability. Also going to cover some of our work on intuition, some really cool research there. But it's really more about learning. It's really more, way more experiential, and learning the actual techniques and that I'll just only briefly refer to some tonight. Make sense? And I have, that's what time? I need to figure that out. 9:30, I think, tomorrow? Wherever it is, somewhere. Yeah. Different than here. I have it programmed in my GPS, so I'll probably find my way
and
there.
And it's on the flyers, and you can sign up for the workshop in the back as well.
Okay, so,
do you
sorry.
Need the machine to do the workshop?
No, of course not. No, you do not need the machine, which is the biofeedback element, to do the workshop or to use any of the HeartMath techniques. It's a serious add-on in terms of facilitating the process and learning the skills. But it's about, HeartMath is really about being able to maintain our composure, if you will, kind of keep our center right in the middle of when the heat of the moment, you know, the traffic jams of life, I like to say, literally and otherwise. That's really what the core HeartMath work is about, you know, giving humanity tools to better. In fact, let me just get into our mission. I just wanted to start with that. This is our mission statement. So it's really to help bring our physical, mental, and emotional systems into balanced alignment with our heart's intuitive guidance. And really helping unfold who we really are, the connections to that deeper part of our undivided wholeness, as David Bowen liked to call it. Okay, so I'm going to just preference the GCI talk with a little bit of some of our older research. I probably touched on some of this in a past presentation to this group, right about 3-4 years ago, last time I was here, something like that. Yeah. Really what I like to call energetic communication. So this is pretty simple in a certain way. We don't have to get too exotic here. When the heart beats, it creates a magnetic field. Okay? And this is the shape of the magnetic field. It is a literal donut shape or toroidal shape. And I'm not talking about an aura. Not that they're not real. I just can't measure those in the laboratory. I can measure the magnetic field. So this is the same magnetic field. I usually get my cell phone off, but I just handed it off so it wouldn't interfere with the microphone. We know that magnetic fields carry information, right? What your cell phone does every time you make a call. It's an electromagnetic wave that's going between your cell phone and the cell tower, or any type of radio, TV, any type of communication system we use. We're using magnetic fields to carry information. Make sense? We do it every day. We know a lot about how to do that. So what I'm going to suggest here a lot tonight is actually we work the same way. Magnetic fields don't just work with cell phones to carry information. So in our physiology, in our bodies, the by far the biggest source of rhythmic electromagnetic energy is the heart. So what we're looking at here is the electrocardiogram, one heartbeat. And why do you suppose it's called the electrocardiogram? What are we measuring? Electricity, right? Right, it's a huge signal from a biological perspective. So when you measure the ECG, you go to the doctor's office or lab, and we put electrodes across your chest. You're measuring the electrical component, flow of current. High school physics, or probably not even high school anymore, probably more like, you know, middle school physics these days. Whenever you have a flow of current, you create a magnetic field, right? So you have to measure that with a different instrument called a magnetometer. And with today's magnetometers, you can measure the heartbeat about 3 feet away from the body. Okay, brain waves, with the same instrument in the same settings, you can measure about an inch away where you lose sensitivity. Of course, in practical senses, you always get the sensor up close because you want to have good signal-to-noise ratios and all that, but you can detect it up to about 3 feet away. Of course, the field, magnetic fields go a lot farther than that. It's just what we can, the sensitivity of the equipment today. Is that me? Could have been. So, you've all had the experience, right? You walk into a room or into a friend's house or a place of business, and it just feels off. Right? You just sort of sense it. And a lot of times you might find out that somebody there just got some really bad news or just had an argument or something. It kind of happens pretty routinely. In our language, boy, you could feel the tension in the air. You could cut it with a knife. Or it just feels really good to be around some other people. So when we do spectral analysis of these magnetic heart-generated magnetic fields, sure enough, there is information encoded in there. So I'm pretty simple. I'm just suggesting the magnetic field acts as a carrier wave for, in this case, information about our emotional state. This will be covered tomorrow in the workshop, but the rhythm of the heart, we now know, reflects discrete emotional states. So we can just look at the beat-to-beat variability in a person's heart rate. In a healthy person, our heart rate changes with every heartbeat. And you can think of that like Morse code. Morse code is pretty simple. We encode information in a time between things, right? You can spell out sentences and words and all that. Today we're about 75% accurate in discrete emotional state detection just from looking at the pattern of the heart, the heart rate variability it's called. And so if we know what the HRV is, we know exactly what the information being encoded in the intervals between the pulses of the magnetic field is. Kind of see it here. Okay, some more fun ways to talk about this. This is a story, I can give the most great lecture. This dot's connected to that dot, the science. And what people remember a week later is this story, which is in a way very unscientific. This is my son Josh and his dog Mabel. He's 12 years old here. He just had his 30th birthday a couple days ago. This is a long time ago, but it's a story that survived time. But being family members made them automatic research subjects. No IRBs to deal with, stuff like that. Get over to the lab and bring your dog. So what we did is we put recorders to record the electrocardiogram, heart rate variability, the beat-to-beat change in heart rate, on Josh and his dog and synchronized them. So this is Mabel on top, and this is her heart rhythms now. This is not the electrocardiogram. This is the beat-to-beat change in the heart rate. And they're all over the place here. And Mabel, the dog, was having a great time because this is off-limits territory she's in now, lab, sniffing around, exploring. Josh is told to go in quietly, just kind of sneak in, sit down in a chair, not to interact with Mabel. No, hi, Mabel, no petting, none of that kind of stuff. Just quietly sit down and do what's called a heart lock-in. It's one of the techniques we'll actually talk about tomorrow. And you can see his heart rhythm shifted here, right? It's what we call heart coherence. It's a coherent rhythm. But look what happened to Mabel. And they're actually quite a few feet apart here. So it turns out animals are amazingly sensitive to our emotional state. And their emotions are also reflected, if we want to give a call on emotions, in their heart rhythms. These experiments actually work amazingly well. Kind of better than I ever thought they would. Hey, same thing, only it's in a corral with horses and humans. Well, here's the human HRV data doing the heart lock-in technique, shifting into coherent state. Look at the obvious state shift in the horses' rhythms. Pretty obvious, right? First time this was done, it was done with four horses and humans, and three out of the four horses had almost identical shifts that you see here, really obvious and almost the same kind of pattern. Maybe this is horse coherence, I don't know. We were blind when trying to do anything proper back then in that study. And the fourth horse, who didn't show any difference at all, found out later, was a horse that had a personality that wanted absolutely nothing to do with humans. Very standoffish kind of personality horse. This has since been, this actually little pilot study has now been duplicated and actually being published in a real formal statistical way and all that kind of cool stuff. So bottom line, animals are very sensitive, dogs and horses, in particular to our emotional states. Energetically speaking, remember there's no, it's all energetic, there's no touching, physical contact here. Same thing, mothers and babies. Now we're using a technique called signal averaging, which I won't go into detail here, but it's a pretty standard signal processing technique to find if two different systems or signals are synchronized in some way. So on top is mom's brainwaves, and on the bottom is the, it's actually an infant in this case, is heartbeats. Again, no physical contact. And what we see here is mom's brainwaves synchronizing to the baby's heartbeat. Now, this was modulated by attention. When mom puts her attention on, her consciousness, her attention on the baby's when her brainwaves literally synchronize, physiologically link up. We distract her, get her off thinking about other things, that synchronization goes away. You can actually watch it come right in and phase out over time and stuff. Here's the same thing, same technique, signal averaging, with adults 5 feet apart. And now we can measure the magnetic field with a $40,000 magnetometer 3 feet away. But this suggests our nervous systems are way more sensitive. We're 5 feet apart here. So we're worth at least $40,000 each. Think of it that way. All right, so basically the blue line is the brainwave of one person, the red obviously the ECG, the signal average ECG, and brainwaves of the other person. And this works. You can have barriers between the people, as long as they're not magnetically shielded. And it works, so there's, eliminating all the, eye contact-y kind of stuff. So there's not, let's not explain this. Okay? Now, there's more to this story, but I'm not going to go into the detail tonight. So what I actually think we have here is maybe one of the first physiological measures of empathy. It kind of goes along with this. That's the bigger story. Okay, this is a study. I'm just going to round it off here that was done. This is a Ph.D. dissertation study. And the guy who did the study went way above and beyond the call of duty to get his Ph.D. actually. What he did is he took 40 people, divided them into groups of four, and they were sitting around a table. They're all wired up, measuring their physiological responses. Three of the four got some training 2 weeks before the experiment and some techniques to shift into a what we call coherent state. This is not the subject for tonight. And an ability to sustain it for at least a couple of minutes. Then the fourth person was clueless. He did not know what, or they did not, it could have been a man or a woman, what the experiment was really about. So then it was a kind of a complex protocol, 9 phases and all that. But basically, these three were signaled when to shift into being coherent, be coherent with intention, just be coherent without intention, all these different phases. And what do you think happened to our fourth person? Let's see if we can read slides here. Right, they were not every person every time, but a very highly significant effect. It was a measurable impact on our fourth person. Again, it's an energetic influence. Now, he also looked at...
Could you mind just saying briefly what is coherence? What's, I know it's not a brief explanation, but...
Yeah, it's, that's a tough one to do briefly. For this discussion, it's the alignment and harmony in the activity of our physiological systems. And it's reflected in our heart rhythms. This is actual heart rhythm data, where the heart rate's increasing and decreasing in a very organized, kind of coherent way. And this is incoherence. Heart rhythms are erratic. It literally reflects the activity in our nervous system. Yeah. And as it turns out, when we feel things, when we actually have heartfelt emotions like love, appreciation, kindness, care, our heart rhythms naturally become more coherent. That's what we're going to talk all about tomorrow. Anyway, okay. The other thing he did was he looked at all the pairwise combinations across all the groups and found that there was literal synchronization going on between all the members that had its own rhythm across all the groups, suggesting a kind of a group field connection. It's kind of the next phase that this research needs to go. And that degree of synchronization was significantly related to how well the people knew each other and liked each other. Right? Make sense? Okay. So I just threw this slide in because Jackie asked me to. Jackie's back there. So one of the devices that helps you learn how to be coherent and see your own heart rhythms is, there's three of them. This is the latest one called Inner Balance for iPhones and iPads, which is also standalone versions and versions for healthcare professionals to train patients. So if you'd like to check one of those out, see Jackie back there at the end of the thing. All right, so this is the mission of the Global Coherence Initiative, which is set as a special project of the HeartMath Institute. It's a science-based project to really help unite people in heart-focused care and intention, and to really facilitate a shift in a global consciousness. That's really our mission, so hopefully you can read that. Here's the high-level hypotheses. Of course, each study has its own sub-hypothesis that fits within this. First one is really not a hypothesis. This is really quite well established. And that is that human and animal health, cognitive functions, our emotions and behaviors are affected by planetary magnetic and energetic fields. Talk a little bit more about that. The second one, we get a little bit wide for some people. Right? But the Earth's magnetic fields act as carrier waves for biologically relevant information, thus connect all living systems. And if that proves to be true, we are suggesting that we then all are all connected to and help inform what we think of as a global information field, and that thus that large numbers of people who are consciously and intentionally creating more heart-centered states of care, love, and being more coherent can generate a more field environment that can really benefit and help offset the current planetary stress waves. Okay, so this is a statement here by a guy named Franz Hallberg. Dr. Franz Hallberg, and I would be surprised if more than one or two of you know who he is. Ever heard of him? Anybody know who Franz Hallberg is? Nobody? How many of you know the term circadian rhythm? Okay, Franz is the man who coined the term circadian rhythm in 1948. Unfortunately, Dr. Hallberg just passed late last year. And it right out his 95th birthday. And he was working, a little story about these kind of passionate people, literally 7 days a week, right up until that time. There's a whole floor at it's called the Old Mayo Building at the University of Minnesota, Hallberg Chronobiology Center. So he's the well-recognized founder of the whole field of chronobiology. So Dr. Hallberg was actually a huge supporter of ours, was on our advisory board, and we actually, honored to say, we published a few papers together in later years and so on. But this is, once he discovered circadian rhythms and the importance across all biological systems, actually, so it turned out, it became clear to him that our circadian rhythms and other biological rhythms weren't just being synchronized to and influenced by day-night things, photons and so on, but that by these invisible things, especially the magnetic fields from the sun and the earth. And he and his colleagues around the world have published literally hundreds of papers on this. All kinds of things. This is not a hypothesis really anymore. So some of the things that is really quite well established is that the rhythms in the Earth's fields are associated with changes in activity in our brain and nervous system, how well we perform on various types of tasks, performance on sporting things and so on. I think we have an expert here. Ed, if I'm not wrong, I think magnetic field disturbance also blocks or messes up remote viewing and psychic experiments as well. Makes good sense. Blood pressure, heart rate. In fact, our blood pressure and rhythms and heart rate can literally synchronize to the rhythms in the Earth's field. Number of traffic accidents and traffic tickets that get written. Number of hospital admissions, actually for a wide range of things, not just heart attacks and strokes. Societal conflicts, criminal activity. And interesting, one of Dr. Hallberg's findings was that the most sensitive system in the human body to changing Earth magnetic fields or solar magnetic fields is the heart, human heart, reflected in heart rate variability. Yes.
You can add epileptic seizures to that.
Oh yeah, it's a wide range. Depression, suicide, the list goes on. Yes, headaches and yeah, high level stuff. Uh-oh. Oh no! Freeze frame. Heart math technique.
Magnetic seizures.
There you go. Okay, well that's Microsoft for you. It's the positive energy in the room here. I think that's what it is. All right, we'll get back on. And this crazy computer, I love Microsoft products. The file you open is not the one that comes up. It's crazy, actually. You have to go through here. All right, where were we? Quit that. God, I did it again. Can't get ahead of ourselves here. Okay. All right, so the first modern, at least this time around, researcher to actually do some real research on the connection between solar activity in this case and human behavior was this guy, Alexander Chesovsky, kind of a famous guy in some circles now. He got drafted into World War I, and being an astrophysicist was kind of keeping one eye on the sun and the solar activity. But it appeared to him that when we had a lot of solar flares going on and during the peak of the solar cycles, that people just got stupid. Right? So this got him intrigued. So after the war, he did an exhaustive study of human history. And it's really amazing what these guys did back then before we had internets and things. I actually read some of the translations of that we can in English of his work. It's very elegant and very thoughtful and very well done. Anyway, he created, at the end of all this, what he called an index of mass human excitability. So the next figure I'm going to show you is his original data. Okay, that was published in 1926. So what we're looking at here on blue, the blue line on top, we're starting in 1749, going across, and it wraps down to here and up to 1926. So what the blue line is representing, we're putting a dot each year for the number of major human events that occurred that year. Okay, this is not Mrs. Jones' cat got stuck in a tree down the road. This is big things, starts of wars, revolutions, major discoveries that had global impact. Okay, so you just put a dot for each year. That's what the blue line is. The red line on the bottom is the solar cycle for the same time period. Yeah, I think there's maybe a correlation there.
So both positive and negative.
We're going to get there. Great question. Give me one slide. Okay, so this has been replicated by many times, brought into modern times. You know, it's a very strong effect. Stock market cycles ride the same thing, right? In fact, the onset in recorded history, as far as we have solar cycle data and war data, the onset of war, 80% of the start of wars have started in a very narrow part of the peak of the solar cycles. 80%. Okay. I did this presentation, something similar in Saudi Arabia a couple years ago, and somebody raised their hand. During that couple year period, why can't we just lock up all the politicians? I didn't know this was going to happen. That's pretty good advice, actually. Right? Well, yeah, with not to the day kind of thing, but yes, this is the sunset cycle. The rhythm here, it's about a 10 and a half to 11 year cycle. So we know every 10 and a half, 11, well, that there's going to be a ramp up period and then, so we just crossed the peak of cycle 24. So right now we're just on the downslope of one of these cycles. So we've still got a couple years of potential rock and roll here. And it's change that matters most. When things change up or down, that's what we tend to react to most. Okay, so you ask a great question. So yes, it's true that 80% of auroras start during those peaks. Those same solar intense periods are also the same exact same periods as the greatest times of flourishing in humanity. Again, some very elegant research that's been done showing independent cultures that had no communication, just everywhere, flourishing goes on in the arts and science and new discoveries and so on. So the way I like to think of this is that it's an energetic influx. I mean, quite literally, during an increased solar cycle, the sun is putting out more energy. Measurably, quite a bit more, especially in the UV spectrums. That filters down into the Earth system, as we'll see in a minute, which eventually filters down into us. So what do we do with that energy is what matters. Do we use it to develop new collaborations, solve problems, think outside of the box, or do we not know how to handle that energy if we're not mature enough, we don't have enough self-regulatory capacity, then we go start squabbles, get in car wrecks, and start wars if you're a politician, right? Make sense? So the way that energy influx hits us, most of humanity, is in our emotions. That's very clear. So we did a study quite a few years ago now, probably 5 years ago, with 1,600 members of the Global Coherence Initiative, close to 200,000 now, but 1,600 people volunteered to participate. And we had this little validated scale. We would randomly send them out at random times over a six-month period, a few times a week, and then correlated that to solar and geomagnetic data. I'm not going to go into that because of time. But pretty clear, when the Earth's fields are disturbed, people are more mentally confused, more foggy mentally, quicker to react, get irritated, frustrated, and so on, more fatigued, less energy at the end of the day. Don't sleep as well. These kinds of things. We also found some positive correlations. As far as I know, it's the first study to actually find positive correlations like this. I'm going to refer back to that later because they've now been confirmed in other types of data that I'll refer back to this later when I get to. So if we're going to do science, we're going to do research, we have to measure things. So to measure what the Earth's doing, we're listening in on the Earth's energetic systems. Okay, I'll define what I mean by energetic systems in a second. Now what we're installing is a global network of ultra-sensitive magnetometers. And these are very specifically designed devices. I wish we didn't have to do this. It is a lot of work and costs a lot of money. But these are different magnetometers, and you go to the NOAA website and download KP data, if you know what that is, and stuff like that. So those magnetometers that they're all over the place measure the intensity of the magnetic field and the ripple on it. You can think of it that way, disturbance. Our magnetometers are these big long things designed to measure the rhythms, what's technically called the time-varying magnetic field, the oscillatory components. Now, I'll share in a minute why that's important. So right now there's six of them. This is the map we want to have eventually. This is the one, this is the Global Coherence Monitoring System, is what GCMS stands for. This is the first one. That's in Boulder Creek, California, where I live. This is the one in Saudi Arabia. So a little, you see this block wall around it. So we're having all the phone conversations with Dr. Abdallah here, who runs a big cardiac hospital in Saudi Arabia, who gets this stuff. We're talking on the phone about installing it. He goes, yeah, we have to build block wall. I'm like, no, it's underground. You don't need a block wall. Yes, we need a block wall. I never asked him why. So it turns out the desert is full of free-ranging camels. Here's a site over here that like to roll on things, rub on things. And they've now had to bring in big heavy equipment, remove this, and the wall's well over my head if you saw it there, and bring, because the sand dust have gotten to the top of the wall twice now. So I learned a lesson. When your local partners say you need to do something, yes sir, you just do it. Here's the fellow who owns the land there that's in Saudi Arabia. He's at a big cardiac conference there. It's Paul Roche, by the way, the president of the American Institute of Stress, good friend. This is one in Canada. Some pictures of it. Lithuania is another one we have installed. New Zealand. Our sites get to live in some really pretty places. Yeah. So I could live there. And the latest one is in South Africa, and it's in a big game park. This is what the So you see this little mini block wall around it, right? There's another picture of it here right as we were finishing the concrete. So the reason that there's a little mini block wall, the manager of the game park comes along and sees our pipe sticking out of the ground with all the wiring for the magnetometer and says, boys, them are going to be elephant toys. They love to pull things out of the ground. So last minute, we had to elephant-proof our magnetometers. It's a very beautiful sight there, so this is actually in the game park. It was a fun installation, you know, the zebras and the giraffes and rhinos and all that roaming around as we were putting the site in. Okay, so tech am I talking about energetic systems? Really two that I'm going to talk about tonight. There's more, but the big player here is what's called the geomagnetic field. We all know what that is, right? That's the thing our compasses tune into. And it radiates out into space hundreds of thousands of miles. Right? And absolutely critical for life on Earth. No geomagnetic field, no life, at least as we know it. Our atmosphere, water, all that would get blown away fairly quickly. And this is kind of an idealized picture of the magnetic field of the Earth, the geomagnetic field. It's kind of like it's like a refrigerator magnet in that it's a pure magnetic field. It's a static or stationary field, it's called. It's just always there. And the magnitude of the field, it changes, but it's over hundreds to thousands of years. For our day-to-day lives, no, it ain't changing. Okay? The magnitude of the strength of the field. Okay, remember back, dial back to whenever it was in science class, about ninth grade somewhere, I think it was for me, where we got to dump iron filings on glass plates and put magnets under it and, you know, move them around. You see all the little lines that form? Those are called flux lines. As it turns out, in the Earth's magnetic field, it has flux lines. There's all these little electrons spinning around them and all this complex stuff going on. So think of those magnetic field lines as guitar strings. And what happens when you pluck a guitar string? Vibrates, right? And it has a frequency or note, right? You change the tension, it changes the frequency. Okay. Well, as it turns out, the magnetic field lines of the Earth are doing exactly that. So a technical term for it is called structural field line resonances. And these are quite big fields. They're not trivial. I'll show you some data in a minute. Okay, so what's plucking the field lines? This is the solar wind. I'm going to use a scientific term here. The solar wind is the stuff being blown out of the sun, which is these staggering numbers, you know, hundreds of billions of tons per second kind of stuff. This is not the day-night photons. This is plasma, highly charged particles and stuff like that. Solar wind, on a nice quiet day, is traveling at about 1,000,000 miles per hour. We have a bunch of solar flares and coronal mass ejections, you know, like blowing out up here. It can, on a big flare, jump up to about 5 million miles per hour. And there's enough pressure all the time from the solar wind that it pushes in the Earth's magnetic field, all the stuff we learned back in high school and then quickly forgot, right? And pulls out the magnetic field on the nighttime side. It's called the magnetotail. Meanwhile, Earth is turning and all that, and so is the sun. So the solar wind is rushing by and plucking the strings. And really cool, just recently, we've got some new satellites up there designed to study this stuff and are actually able to visualize the ringing field lines. Is that cool or what? It's brand new. You can see some different images where we actually see the vibrating, the ringing of the field lines. Okay, so when we do spectrums of the field line resonances, this is what the spectrums look like. So we have a peak that comes and goes, but there's always some there. But one of the primary resonances that's most often there is at a frequency of 0.1 hertz. Okay, so I know you haven't taken heart math courses, so that probably doesn't mean anything to you yet. As it turns out, all of these, I'll show you why that's important in a minute, all of these rhythms in the field line resonance mode or category overlap the rhythms of the human heart and animals and the rhythms in our autonomic nervous system.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit of each. What's your question? What's your question? Depends on what we're talking about, I guess.
Well, but I'm a,
yeah, I don't know. Let's save that one. That's going to go off topic here. Okay, so when I talk about a coherent heart rhythm, this is what I'm talking about. So this is, you asked earlier about heart. This is HRV data, heart, the beat-to-beat change in our heart rate. So this is what our heart rhythm is beating out when we're feeling frustrated or irritated, and this is what we call a coherent state that's naturally associated with positive states, feeling good, and so on. The frequency of a coherent heart rhythm is 0.1 hertz. So in other words, the primary resonant frequency of the Earth's fields when they're vibrating, the field line resonances, and our hearts, especially when we're in a coherent state, are identical. Okay, another set of energetic or magnetic fields that are important have to do with the ionosphere. So the ionosphere, from back to high school, right, is a, think of it as a big soap bubble around the planet. Starts about 50 miles up from the surface and goes out to about 100 miles, to 150. And it's a this bubble of plasma, it's called. It's the physicists consider the fourth state of matter. It does some pretty special stuff, the way it responds to magnetic fields and so on. And there's a whole bunch of currents and flows. That's not what we're going to talk about tonight, but they are relevant. But the bottom of the ionosphere, think of it like a mirror to lower frequency magnetic waves. So some of you might know ham radio operators or amateur radio guys. The way that works, you send up your radio signal. They can't send them through the earth. It hits the ionosphere and bounces off. Okay, so this is how you talk to somebody in England or China or something. If you're really lucky, you get a second bounce, and you're talking to somebody in Australia or South Africa or something. You know, they love that, that's what they live for, right? But the point here is to think of the bottom of the ionosphere reflecting magnetic waves. So we have a cavity across here in between the Earth and the ionosphere. So magnetic waves that get set up in this cavity become the globally propagating standing waves, is a technical term. It'll be a test later. That just means they're everywhere and they're always there. And those are called Schumann resonances, after a German guy, Otto Schumann, who first predicted their existence in the mid-1950s. And then they were first experimentally measured in basically 59 and 1960. We've come a long way since then in our ability to measure these things. There's actually 8 of them. Most people just know about the first one. Not even the most powerful, or 7.8 hertz, the first Schumann frequency. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Think physiology? What? Well, yes, but what in terms of us, our physiology? Brain waves, low alpha rhythm, low alpha. All of these humans overlap human brainwave frequencies and rhythms. This is what we just said. We have the earth singing away, if you will, the same frequency as our heart and autonomic nervous system and our brain waves. Okay, so back to high school physics. Same science class, we got to get out tuning forks. Right? You know, and you bang one and somehow magically the other one starts to vibrate in unison with it. Right? Demonstrating the principle of resonance. Of course, in our tuning forks, we've got air molecules communicating the energy between them. Or guitar strings tuned to the same frequency, you know. So basically, when you have two systems that are resonant at the same frequency, you can transfer energy and information, one or the other or both. One thing I didn't teach us back then about tuning forks and guitar strings and things is to be a resonant system, it has to be a coherent system. So what I just say, here we are, humanity, our brains and hearts vibrating away at the same frequency as Earth. I think there might be some chance, at least a reasonable hypothesis, that some energy might and information might get exchanged there. So one of the ideas back in the 60s, And there was a lot of research on measuring Schumann resonances and all this stuff for about 10 years, and nothing since, hardly. All the funding dried up. Was that, being as these things are global, if you measure them one place, they're the same everywhere. You don't need a bunch of these stations around. Here's the data from here in California, New Zealand, and Canada. I think that hypothesis needs some serious updating. There are very different signals in different places. Yes, globally correlated to a certain degree with very significant local and individual differences. Here's another example of California and Canada. Now here's something that I still don't have an answer to. So what we see are these very fast, high amplitude peaks in the magnetic field data. So when we had our first sight or two, it's probably an airplane flew over or something, or some man-made something, you know, artifact. Now that we've got six sites, all very highly time-synchronized, no, they are happening globally.
Not probably related to sprites.
No, that's a whole other octaves way above what we're talking about here. These are fast, high amplitude spikes. So I've sent this data to a few people now, world experts in geomagnetics, and been to a few conferences. Nobody can tell me nobody knows what these are. So I finally tracked down NOAA, you know, the world experts, talked, and I actually literally finally got to talk to the person at NOAA in Boulder, Colorado, whose full-time job it is just to remove these spikes from the data. Absolutely true story. We don't know what they are. We can't have them messing up our KP index calculations. No. No. They're nothing they do with HARP. I assure you. They come and go, and they have rhythms and all this kind of stuff to them. We've just written a bunch of algorithms. Remember, we got lots of data 24/7 from lots of sites, so we've just written some new software and put in a computer to be able to do this kind of analysis.
Did they give you an answer?
No, they don't know. I'm waiting to, finally, somebody's got to know. I'll run into somebody. He goes, we know what these are, but yeah.
What's the frequency of this aberration?
Well, I wouldn't say that's a frequency because this is a quarter of a second here. So these things are really fast and really high amplitude.
So when does it occur again?
They're going on all the time.
Oh,
I don't know. I mean, they vary. It's kind of nonlinear. They're always there. You think of it in the order of 20 to 50 an hour.
Are they local to the Earth? Could they be related to solar? There's no satellites that can measure whether the same fields.
Not the kind of resolution we're measuring. I mean, this is a unique system. We're sampling at high sample rates and time-locked around the world. I mean, the NOAA magnetometers that just measure the DC, they measure once a minute, right? We're sampling, you know, hundreds per second type sample rates. So, yes?
Do you see that in the human heart?
Not like this, no.
No, but I mean, for example, of course, it's a different proportion, dimension, or whatever. But what is the cause when you observe something like that in a human heart?
Yeah, I'm not sure if we're quite following your question, because we don't see this in human hearts quite like this.
No, in an electrocardiogram, you never see anything like that.
No, not unless it's an arrhythmia or something, that kind of arrhythmic event.
Well,
no.
An arrhythmia.
Yeah, well, yeah, I don't know. I think, in fact, the only place I've run across a description that's very close to this, somebody else turned me on to it, is in esoteric writings.
In what?
Some of the more esoteric writings. You know, about pulses coming from the center of the Earth out, and you know, but I'm not saying this is that. I'm saying I don't know what they are. Yeah, Ed?
Is this a geomagnetic phenomenon or a solar wind phenomenon?
It's not solar wind.
Not solar wind.
No. No, I mean, I don't know what it is. I mean, it could be something ringing the fields globally. It could be a separate magnetic pulse coming from the center of the Earth. It could be something coming from a big wave coming external. Well, we've been observing it for about 8 years since we've been having magnetometers. But NOAA's been seeing it. I mean, you see it in flux gate magnetometers like NOAA use.
Yeah.
you know, the pulses. They got somebody full time getting rid of them. Right?
So how long has he been removing them?
Well, probably since they started measuring. I don't know. I didn't. I was just stunned when I said, "Oh yeah, I'm the person who removes them from the data." I didn't know what to say next, other than what do you think they are? Oh, we don't have any clue. So okay. All right. So this is a data we're not actually publishing this way, but this is a study data from a. This looks like a complicated graph, so don't try and follow all the numbers and colors and everything. But what we did is we had a group of people in Saudi Arabia. As it turned out, because we have a local site there, who wore recorders that record the electrocardiogram 24 hours a day to record their heart rate variability, which reflects nervous system activity, for 5 months. Okay, not every day, I think it was 4 days a week for 5 months. As far as we know, by far the longest study that's ever been done to look at correlations between nervous system activity and solar and geomagnetic activity. Dr. Hallberg had done them over a couple of weeks and things like this. Some surprises. So if the lines, so all the different colors represent different HRV stuff. Don't worry about all that. And then the various solar and geomagnetic measures. So here's solar wind speed. So if the lines are going down, that means it's a negative correlation. In other words, solar wind speed goes up, our heart rate variability goes down. You don't want your heart rate variability going down. That's not a good thing. You want it going up. Okay, surprising. This is a F107. What that's a measure of is what's called the solar radio flux. This is a 2.8 gigahertz radio wave that is emitted by the sun. When it's increasing, our HRV increases. In that other study I mentioned earlier, the 1,600 people, that's where we first saw it. When F107 goes up, people were less mentally fogged, they felt better, slept better, did all that. And here we saw it in the HRV as well. So again, as far as I know, it's the first study to show positive correlations. Another positive correlation, cosmic rays. Okay? So, but of course we know solar wind and cosmic rays are inversely correlated. And there was some other stuff. And then we saw some pretty cool stuff in terms of the that supports our hypothesis that it's the rhythms in the field that overlap our physiology that matter. In fact, the thing that hardly correlates at all is this thing called KP index, which is what most studies have been based on because it's the only measure they have. But the time-varying field is what matters. Okay, now, another study. This was 30 people who wore recorders. A group who wore the HRV recorders over a 30-day period continuously, 24 hours a day for 30 days. Now, the primary question we were asking was, you know, all this other correlation stuff like I just showed you. Yeah, it's there. That's cool. But what I'm showing you here is what we did not expect to see. So here's the basic process. For some of you, this will matter. We removed all the circadian rhythm effects from the data, geomagnetic, solar, and the human HRV data. Time synchronized them very closely, and basically averaged it all together, the HRV data, across this group of people. Now, this group of people are spread across the state of California. In fact, some are in Southern California, some in Northern California. It's not like they're all buddies living and working and communing together kind of thing, right? This is their HRV data over the 30 days. So I need to back up a little bit. What one would expect when you average interbeat interval data from a group of people together over 30 days is nothing. A flat line, just averaged out to nothing. This is what we have. That's not a flat line. Not only that, it has a rhythm. And this is wrong. It's actually an average of 2.5 days, the frequency of the cycle. So this is the group's heart rhythms being synchronized. Okay, now what the heck happened here? The whole group's HRV shot up. Well, as life would have it, we had a big solar flare in the middle of our 30-day period. Oh, first I need to back up. Okay, sorry, I got ahead of myself. Okay, so what the heck could explain this? I'm not a person who believes in magic. I think there's mechanisms to all this wacky, weird stuff we discover. So we looked at, well, after the shock settled, we actually got our wits back about us, realized this implies that humanity, or at least our group of people here, are synchronizing to an external source, some external field. Guess what that is? The time-varying magnetic field. It's exactly what our magnetometers are measuring. This is actual field data. You almost see the correlations in it. Right? When you can see correlations in time series data, it's significantly quite strong, which it is, over the 30-day period. Now here, what the heck's going on again? Here's this crazy thing. Okay, well, the red line now that I'm adding is the F107, the solar radio flux. Okay, now it's radio wave, it gets speed of light, you know, the sun blows a bunch of it out, it gets here in 8 minutes. All right, so you see it increasing. Following right behind that is this big increase in HRV. It takes 3 days for the disturbances to get here, the solar wind, the plasma waves and all that from the sun. That's the blue line. So as soon as it starts hitting, the HRV starts crashing, our group goes out of synchronization, things settle down, and they start coming back into sync over here. Is this cool or what? I mean, if you really get what's happening here, this is like, this is blow away. We did not expect this. So this implies that we are more fundamentally connected with each other and Earth than we ever dreamed we would see. Okay, so this has got to be verified. So the next step, is this happening globally? I don't know yet, but we are in the middle of a study to answer that question. So we had groups, we're through with data collection, and we're now into data analysis. It's a huge undertaking. So we have 20 people in 5 countries, all wearing their recorders for continuously for the 2-week period, 15 days. Doing some other cute, fun things in synchronize and ask a few other questions. So we had a group in New Zealand, California, Lithuania, Saudi Arabia, and actually England. I don't have their picture on here. Okay. So.
Have you had a chance to look at any raw correlations before the final analysis?
Well, this is a huge undertaking. You think of 120 people. That much HRV data. We just got the HRV data cleaned and analyzed, so we're right in the middle of analyzing it. So maybe if you invite me back someday, I'll be able to give you the answer to the global level. We've got some hints already. We just got the HRV data done. Okay, one of the hypotheses I suggested was that magnetic fields carry biologically relevant information that connect us all, and thus we all affect the system. So there's actually several lines of evidence for that. Being a reasonable hypothesis. Can't say it's slam dunk proven yet by any means. This is my sort of current favorite one. And some of you may remember this. It made the scientific media storm about 3 years ago, I guess it was. With a lot of people not liking this being published, how dare you publish this kind of work. It got published because it was, and I'm terrible with French names, so you'll have to suggest me, but Luc Montagnier, thank you, who is a Nobel Prize winner for discovering, right, the HIV virus. And the other guy here who was really the brains behind it is a quantum physicist, Emilio, Italian names I'm not great with either, Delgucci. Thank you. Emilio, I had an opportunity to meet and hang out with him some. He also passed away last year, way too young of an age. A very brilliant guy who's written a lot of papers and a lot of experimental data on, guess what? Earth's magnetic field as interconnecting all living systems. And his big thing was water being the interface for that. So he was really the brains behind this. All right, I'm going to shortcut kind of what all happened here. But basically, they created a magnetically shielded environment, Inside the magnetically shielded environment are 2 coils. One's a measurement coil, one's a coil to create fields that they could control. So what the experiment was. First thing I did is put a test tube of water with DNA fragments in it, DNA, and found that they could measure electromagnetic signature coming off the test tube with the water and DNA in it. Yeah, that's not that revolutionary. That's been done before, you know, that kind of thing. Then they found that they put a second test tube of water in, just pure water with no DNA or anything in it, and then stimulated the environment, again with the first test tube which got the DNA in it, and then a test tube of pure water, with a 7.8 hertz magnetic field, very weak 7.8 hertz magnetic field, about the same what we'd be experiencing from the Earth, that they could now measure the same electromagnetic structure, frequency coming from the test tube of just water. Okay, that's kind of cool. Next step, they put the constituents of DNA in a test tube of pure water. And then, and only if you stimulated the environment with 7.8 hertz magnetic field, the same as the Earth frequency, DNA formed in the test tube that had a 98% exact match to the original DNA. This was not popular to get published. In fact, he has now moved to China. He moved to China late last year. Some of you know the story. To have more academic freedom to do his research. Yeah, he's now in China to do, because he's more free to do this kind of research. Huh? Yeah. So this, okay, so I know about this and some of the insides because of a very close friend of mine who's friends with him, another Italian stem cell engineer, Carlo Ventura. And so 11 different labs have been able to validate, to replicate this. Some labs have not. Okay, so it's still, you know, I'm not trying to say slam dunk, you know, this is it, but no, this is interesting. And with 11 replications, and a few that didn't work, including my friend Carlo wasn't able to replicate it. But, you know, and there's other lines of influence that suggest magnetic fields carry information. Okay, how are we doing on time? 8:30. Well, I mean, because a lot of you know about the RNG data, the Global Consciousness Project, right? I think you probably heard about this. Really? Okay. All right, okay. So another kind of system that's out there measuring global field effects is the Global Consciousness Project. Roger Nelson, who's the head of that now, good friend of mine, actually. And it basically, what has been discovered a long time ago by some self-described wacky physicists, I think we might have one of them in the room here tonight, actually, found that in the presence of strong emotionality, things that are supposed to be random aren't as random as they should be. Small but measurable effect. Did I say it fair enough, Ed?
There's a deeper story here.
Of course there is. Of course there is. But we'll keep it kind of simple. The largest effect ever measured on this global network of these devices, random number generators around the world, was during the 9/11 terrorist attacks. So we see a big deviation instead of just around zero. And then this has been going on for quite a few years now. This is a global prayer day. I need to update this. This is 2011. So we see the deviation from zero. The funnest thing, that I like best that Roger's done, is he took, I think it was 180 some events and analyzed them for their level of love and compassion. So global prayer days, peace days, things like that, high love and compassion. Then we have those that are medium, you know, soccer games, you know, World Cups and things like that. And then low, which would be terrorist attacks, school shootings, and so on. Reanalyzed them and found that those in the high love and compassion had a greater effect than those in medium or low. Okay. Now some people can argue with the data, and that's fine. But I like the story because it suggests that when we're more compassionate, more loving, more appreciative, more kind, that our physiological rhythms, that's tomorrow's workshop subject, becomes more coherent naturally. So I'm saying that also, and so do our fields, that we can measure that. This is measurable. And that then, if our hypothesis is correct, increases our coupling to the larger field environment, the Earth's field, which then affects all other living systems. This data supports that, so I like it. So basically, our model here is that it all starts with us. Each taking our own individual responsibility, us becoming more coherent, more managed, responsible for our energy. And what I like to suggest that you ask yourselves at the end of the day, or maybe even moments during the day, is what am I feeding the field? Because it all counts. If I'm even close to right, it all counts. How much of it are you really being compassionate, kind, caring? Or how much of it are we feeding the field our judgments, our anxiety, our frustrations because our to-do list didn't get done fast enough? Right? So as we work together, starting with us, then as we work together, especially those of you that become trainers and really help others learn about this stuff, that moves us to social coherence. As our classrooms, communities, groups like this start working together to really consciously be more coherent. Right? And we get enough groups like that around, that moves us to eventually to global coherence. I'm not naive. This isn't going to happen overnight. Right? But it matters. So, and we do regular full moon care focuses. You know, you can see actually a couple thousand people in there on those kind of synchronized things. But about any time you go in, there will be anywhere from 50 to 100, 200 people around the world. And it's not uncommon, a lot in Europe, a lot in the U.S., South Africa, Asia. You'll see them from all over the globe. I think there's members from 158 countries now in GCI. So it's a fun thing. It's all free. So if you're not, I'd love to invite you to become a member of the Global Coherence Initiative and at least make some energetic contributions, if you're so inclined. Okay, now I got to take you out in time. So this been good so far? All right, so now you have to sit through an infomercial. I'll be brief. So we do an annual event. This will probably be the last year we do it, actually, in collective coherence, co-create a new world. We're actually going to do some experiments this time. When is it? Okay, December 2nd through 5th. And this is done in the Cancun area. It's actually in Tulum, where the Mexican, the Mayan ruins are. And what we basically do is we have morning workshops, and I go way more into depth in the science of GCI. And the first day is really about the techniques of heart math and a bunch of fun stuff, and then a more advanced training on the last day. Afternoons are off to go swim with the sea turtles and the dolphins and that kind of thing. And then we get back together in the evenings and do focused lock-ins, as we call them, to really help bolster the planetary field environment. It's a really cool place, 5-star hotel. It's all-inclusive, and pretty cool pictures, right? I saw, my first year I went, I saw these pictures, I'm like, yeah, right, airbrushed. No, it's actually, the pictures don't do it justice. I was shocked at how nice this place is. And when they say all-inclusive, it really is. I mean, everything. Airport pickup, everything. You don't need to take any money with you other than if you go out shopping somewhere. It's really cool. And then the actual trainings we do are called, it's a place called the Dow Wellness Center, which is a kind of a 3-story thing. We do it on the top level, and you're seeing the canopy of the rainforest all around this glass all the way around. It's a pretty cool place to do it. And they've got lots of other things you can do. And then private beach, that I say literally go swim with the sea turtles. And I missed it, but one of the people there last year saw a 7-foot sea turtle. I was like, God, I wanted to do that. You know, I only got to see the 3-foot ones, you know. But anyway, that's in December, and would love, if you're so inclined, to see some of you there. And I think last year we had people in 12 countries. So it's a fun place to hang out and talk to people who think kind of like we do, a little bit out of the box, and so on. So yes, I guess we can now take some questions. And
so why is this the last year you're
here? Because it's same place, we've done it in the same place. It's time for somewhere new, and I'm not sure where that's going to be yet. It's hard to match the economics of this place, because what you get for the price is it's like crazy, ridiculous, you know, how cheap this place is for what we were able to pull off there. I'd like to do it in South Africa is where I'd like to do one, actually. Yes.
In your studies of the shamans, has there been any change over the time you've been studying that?
You mean in the frequency of the shamans?
Yeah.
No. In fact, they are exactly the same as they were when they were first measured in 1960. So reports of the Schumann resonance frequencies increasing are utter nonsense.
Yeah. I'd go even further that if there were a change, we're all in deep trouble.
Yeah, absolutely, because it means the geometry. Yeah, it's crazy. No, it's now there are seasonal changes in the amplitude, especially the second harmonic. So if you're just monitoring over a couple of months, oh, wow, it's increasing in amplitude. Yeah, it is. But if you look at it long enough, it's cyclic. It does that. It's seasonal. Yeah.
Why the second?
I don't know why, But that it has the biggest change as the second harmonic in terms of the seasonal variation. But it has to do with the layers of the ionosphere and ion density and that kind of stuff. Yes?
Has there been any correlation with the space program and working together with the space?
Interesting question. Did everybody hear a question? Okay, any stuff working with the space program? One of our collaborators is actually a guy not too far from here, NASA Ames. Pretty smart guy. And he believes, he's got some pretty crazy, he's even crazier than I am in some ways. But he's well published, lots of Nature publications and science. I mean, he's a pretty smart dude. He is convinced that magnetic fields are absolutely critical for healthy living function. And he's got some pretty neat experimental data that if you actually, it's hard to do. It's really hard to shield magnetic fields. There's only one place on Earth I know that can actually do it. And that's a very expensive room, in a multi-seven room. It starts out a giant room and gets down to a little square box in Berlin. He's absolutely convinced that we should be putting field generators on the space station like the Russians did for healthy function. Got some crazier ideas, but I won't speak for him. No, the Russians did. We don't. Yeah, Mir had them. Yeah. Field generators that replicate the field environment we're used to living in here on Earth. Yeah. Yes.
Would the experiments and things that like TN had done, where so many people meditate mm-hmm. and the crime rate goes down, is that incorporated or like correlated with this?
I don't know that it's correlated because they didn't have the kind of magnetic data that we do. I'm still obviously familiar with the studies, but it's an example of the power of collective intention. I mean, there's some problems with some of those studies, but enough of it was done to show that, hey, there's probably something here. Yeah. Ed?
I have a sort of a chicken and an egg question for you. humans have been around, archaeological evidence sure. dating back, 8 to 10 million years or something of that order.
Well, at least that long.
And the problem is that that's short order compared to the geomagnetic fields yes. and all that.
Right.
So I'm curious to know which came first, the magnetic field. I mean, we would, through evolution, it's not a big surprise to me that we're still connected right. to the Earth's magnetic field rather than the other way around.
Of course. In fact, that was exactly Dr. Hallberg's hypothesis and what he was writing about before he passed away. I mean, he's very clear. He said, look, We have the physiological rhythms we do because we evolved in the Earth's field. It's encoded in our DNA because of we evolved in it. It can't be any other way. That's Dr. Hallberg, and it's hard to argue with a man that had close to 3,000 academic publications in his career.
I was just wondering, thanks for struggling with these names that were from various countries on that one study,
yeah.
and you said they had a bit of an issue trying to publish. I think that was
yeah.
the one study you said that. Are there a few keywords that I could use to
DNA teletransportation. DNA teletransportation is what they published it under. Bit stretchy, but yeah.
So most of the frequencies, say looking at were
Yeah, the field line resonances, the field line resonances are all subhertz.
So have you looked at stuff that's like X-ray, gamma ray frequencies?
Yeah, well, that's what the F107 is. It's not X-ray, it's 2.8 gigahertz.
I'm talking about more like nuclear.
Yeah, I haven't. But interesting there, though. Yeah, well, that's an interesting thing here, too. Boy, I need you to ask that question. Okay, so the K-rates, nuclear isotopes, is kind of where you're going. So, God, how many years ago was it? A paper came out showing that our cherished laws of physics, that nuclear decay rates is this random process, wasn't so random, that it had a yearly cycle that correlated with the solar cycle. Then that was duplicated by a completely different group and a completely different isotope. Right? And then another group found that during solar storms, that there's even a whole other ripple on it. So then this led to kind of a, in the certain circles that know about it, a bit of a flurry, because this means our understanding of quantum physics isn't complete. There must be another particle we don't know about, you know, right, things like that. So, but because it implies that global big processes are being modulated by, and it, what it correlated with was the distance between the sun and the earth. And then, of course, neutrons was blamed for it, which was probably not that. But yeah, so anyway, but, yeah.
Personally, for me, the saddest part of your work is the fact that you have to keep trying to prove that it's real, that it exists. Because if you approach this from the experiential, all right, and please, it's, you know, you well, if you can, if you do that, you will see how it works and how it ties in. Then it's not a question of if it does, it's a question of how you experience it. Please excuse the commercial, the bold commercial, but I'm giving a talk Sunday up in San Francisco on experiential pragmatic integralism, which will take your work and show exactly why it is true, why it works, and allow you, you know, when that becomes the way we all think, when that becomes the way we experience, then you no longer have to prove the science. Is it true? You can use it for making it a better world. I agree.
We're just not there yet. And unfortunately for a lot of people, well, maybe that's not so unfortunate. Science is the new religion.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
There's something called pulsal EMF, PEMF. Sure. And, that's sort of what a lot of people are saying, that that's very good for you. Yeah. So, and that's a human frequency. And you take these frequencies several times per day, and circulation is better, wounds heal better, things of that nature. So that's something else out there today.
All right, cool. Yes.
Is there logic or reason for the 7 or 6 sites that we have around the world that have the meters?
Well, we want 12 eventually. And where they're located has to do with geometry. So we want them in the northern and the southern hemisphere and around the equator on the daytime and the nighttime side, and as we're turning into and out of the day and nighttime side. So it's really geometry. But of course, you can't get it perfect, because that would be in the middle of the ocean. And so you do the best you can. Get as close as you can to that. Let us have some other hands. Yes.
Some of your stories, like the ones with the animals and people, were showing a correlation between heart rhythms and brain waves.
Some were, but mostly heart rhythms.
Yeah, I was wondering why. Like, did you check like heart rhythms against heart rhythms? Did it need to be brain waves against heart rhythms?
You can do either.
Okay.
You just have to use different signal processing techniques, because brain waves are obviously a way faster rhythm than heart rhythms. So you have to, that's where you use signal averaging different.
But if you did brain again, the brains compared to the hearts compared, you would see the same correlation or not?
Well, I'm not sure how to answer. We would probably have to refine that question a little bit for me to really be able to answer it. But there's a lot of correlations between our heart and brain waves and our own hearts.
Yeah, so, it was not clear to me whether it was necessary to use the heart and the brain, the two different subjects, in order to get that correlation.
Well, you don't have to, but it's an interesting thing to do.
Yeah.
To see one person's brainwave synchronized into another person's heartbeats 5 feet away is an interesting thing to see, actually, that it actually happens. I mean, but you don't have to do any of this, I guess. Okay, there was something else I was going to mention. I forgot what it was. Yeah.
Well, I stopped learning physics in kindergarten, so maybe a really Arabic question. Are the waves that we use for cell phone transmission, do they in any way affect all these things?
I don't know. This is the honest answer. I know that a lot of money has been spent on research on that, and it's not a clear-cut story. Most of the data shows no. But at the same time, I know for a fact there are people who are extremely sensitive to magnetic fields like this. Fortunately, it's pretty rare. But at the same time, more and more of that kind of magnetic pollution, if you think of it that way, is occurring too. So, but the one thing that is clear is the modulation frequencies used on cell phones. The cell phone companies have known this quite a while. If you modulate the signal at physiological rhythms, you have problems. You can induce seizures and things like that. Yes, Ed?
You know, I have a little information on that. A colleague of mine from Moscow, who comes from an institution with a great name, the Institute for Higher Nervous Activity. But this woman is Natalia Lebedeva, won the Lenin Prize for the best science work in Russia at that time. She did a detailed longitudinal study for IIT, Telecom, with regard to the effects of cell phones and brainwaves. And she found a weak correlation with alpha rhythm. And I said to her, hey, that means you shouldn't drive down the road with your eyes closed, because that's where you make a lot of alpha rhythm. But other than that, there's no definitive real.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Other than the modulation frequency, that's pretty definitive. If you modulate the carrier at a brainwave, you can induce seizures and things. But that's been known quite a while. Yes?
You were talking about the synchronicity between the hearts and the brains of animals and people. And I read about Man of War, who was this Triple Crown winner. And his groomsmen, when they started to work together, and when the groomsman would get sick, the horse would get sick. When the groomsman got better, the horse got better. And this went on, and when the groomsman passed, 3 months later, the horse passed. That's how connected they were.
I saw some, thank you for that. Sorry. I saw somebody else, said, where was it? Yes.
Hesitate to ask this question, but maybe following up on Ed's question. As we know, magnetic fields can work both ways. Mm-hmm. So if the heart emits magnetic field, an external magnetic field could act on the heart.
Absolutely.
And since you've been doing research around the world, my question is, are you aware of any attempts we should be aware of weaponizing this effect?
I don't think that way. No, I know there's some Russians. I hear the Russian stories, some stories about that. Ed, you probably know more about this than I do.
How about multi-Tesla fields where they routinely put patients in these things for MRIs and that like?
Yeah.
Your heart's right in the middle of that.
Oh yeah, I mean I would avoid MRIs unless I really had to have one for something serious. I mean, the ECG, the morphology of the ECG is dramatically changed when you're in an MRI. Lots of stuff that I don't think is healthy goes on. That one thing I'll just remind, a group that ended up being a really strong collaborator with us is a group in Lithuania, actually. That's why we put the magnetometer there at the University of Lithuania. Some really smart guys. It's a cardiology group, sports science group, and some really strong mathematicians, different groups. And he called me, actually, Skype me, just the other day, very excited, Alpha, we call him, because I can't pronounce Lithuanian names either. Hard for me. But anyway, he goes, Ron! So they've just done a study where they've looked at 5-minute ECGs, the electrocardiogram, over a bunch of days, over a bunch of doctors, over a bunch of months. And he said, you're not going to believe this. We are seeing, I can't even believe the correlations we're seeing between morphology changes in the ECG and the time-varying magnetic field. I mean, this is to a level you just can't argue with. I mean, literally QRS complex duration changes and a whole bunch of stuff that has some pretty deep implications. Anyway, some neat stuff coming out. Hopefully get published here for one of these days. We get time to write about this stuff. Yes?
Is there any thought about which changed first? Positive?
Well, in this case, I'm pretty sure it's the Earth's magnetic field data, and we're responding to it.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm certainly not suggesting that our little hearts are going to change the Earth's magnetic field. I am not. Please don't go away here saying, Roland said that we can, because I am not saying that. Yeah. Yes? Well, the moon certainly has effects.
Right, is there a way to even test other planets?
Other planets? Probably, but I don't know how to do it. I don't have time to even think about that. I mean, it's really interesting, and I'm sure there probably are things, gravitational and things that... Yeah. The moon I have to deal with because it's in our face, and it's going through the magnetic tail once a month and creating disturbances that we can measure and stuff like that. Yeah.
In relation to her query, it was interesting that at the time you saw that very significant anomalous spike that NOAA or somebody was erasing. Yeah.
I mean, they're going on all the time. Don't forget.
Right.
24/7.
You said 20 to 50 per hour.
Yeah, in that range, yeah. Mm-hmm.
20 to 50 per hour. It could be related to something extraterrestrial, planet.
Absolutely. Yeah, it could be.
Saturn.
No, it could be. I literally don't know. I hope to run into somebody who actually does know.
With a magnetic field, because some of the planets out there don't have an appreciable magnetic field.
Yeah. So. Could be.
Yeah, we don't know.
I mean, the most obvious thing was magnetic field line recombination, but we've kind of ruled that out as that's not, because we know when the tail gets stretched and snaps, that has a very clear signature as well identified. This ain't it.
Jupiter, with its 11-year cycle around the sun, is correlated with the sunspot sun. So we have a planet there.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. My worldview is it's all interconnected in a very deep and fundamental way that we don't really appreciate or understand yet. So I'm just doing my little part to look at the little slices we can look at and try and help people be more kind to each other and compassionate and, you know, treat each other right, you know.
If you look around the world, it doesn't seem to be working too well these days.
So, okay, what time are we supposed to end this?
Nine.
Okay, we're 2 minutes over time.
9:30.
I mean, I'm okay. I just don't want to. It's 9:00. It's time to be over. If you want to leave, go for it. You know. Tomorrow is the workshop at 9:30. It's going to be very different than this. We're actually going to be experiential. We're going to teach heart math tools, talk about intuition, heart rate variability, how the heart and brain communicate, the stuff we mostly do.
Rollin, will you stay? And if people have questions, they can come in. I will. See you, and then we'll
for a few minutes, sure.
Yeah, okay.
I still have to drive an hour tonight.
Exactly.
Okay. No, I'll stay for a while.
Okay.
Yes.
So there were a couple of kind of tangential things that I wanted to think about, like. The nuclear decay rates of the isotopic
that
were variable, does that mean that all of our carbon dating is wrong?
Yeah, well, it has a lot of implications. But yes, I don't know that it means they're wrong or not. But it's real data. I mean, there is a yearly cycle that has to do with the distance between the sun and the earth in multiple isotopes and multiple labs independent of each other.
About the being able to replicate DNA this magnetic field, and I was wondering, could that be a mechanism for the diaspora of DNA throughout the galaxy or something?
Well, I mean, if magnetic fields carry biologically relevant information, who knows what's...
Get example data on that one. It's going to be a little difficult.
Yeah, it might be.
Yeah. I mean, Michael Persinger's done some pretty cool stuff, you know, that suggests magnetic fields carry information and stuff. I mean, like, we know, one of the things we look at is intuition. I mean, take it out of science. Ask any mother. They know that their kid, in a high ratio, just got hurt, and they're on the other side of the planet or the other side of the city. Right? So again, I don't believe in magic. Well, I do, but it's just that we don't understand it yet. So why couldn't the magnetic, something's got to connect that. Right? Why couldn't that be the magnetic field carrying that information? And our emotions, something we actually care about, is what tunes the resonance to what we pull out of the field. I think simply, you know. Yeah. Yeah, I said something here, all kinds of hands on it.
Why would it have to be magnetic?
Doesn't.
Okay.
Magnetic is something I can measure, it's plausible, and we can test. Yes.
What happened on the American Space Station when they didn't have the right resonance?
I have no idea.
Earthquakes and your work.
Earthquake. Okay, that's a good question, actually. All right, so here, it reminds me of a fun, I don't know. I could go several ways with this one. I'm going to tell you a funner story. I mean, there actually are correlations between the currents in the ionosphere and earthquakes, kind of the camel that broke the doll's back. But another part of the interconnectivity research we're doing is we're actually monitoring trees. So we're putting electrodes in trees. Trees have a very rich electrical life. And this is another one of our NASA Ames collaborators, who's the father of pre-earthquake signals. So he's got a very, very cool, elderly gentleman now, and getting kind of famous, model where he's done all the lab work, experimental evidence, that's a whole new mechanism that shows when rocks are under stress, this is different than piezoelectric effects, they turn into batteries. And they generate substantial currents that, over months, that actually flow quite rapidly and over long distances. So when you have faults increasing the pressure, you have these currents that migrate to the surface, and they actually ionize the air. And then as you have these giant positive ion clouds floating up, which pull down the ionosphere, which actually explains some of the pre-earthquake signals we're actually seeing in our data and other magnetic data. But what's really cool about it is trees and their root system are great sensors for these ground potential changes. So I'm not going to say it's all solved, but we're actually seeing it in our own data and some other people around the world in Japan and others as well, that about 3 weeks before larger earthquakes, 5.0 and above, we see a pretty substantial shift in tree potential data. Trees, the tree potentials, the actual potentials of trees when you measure them. The voltages. The voltage potentials. They have circadian rhythms and they do all kinds of funny little things that we don't understand. So right now we're actually working to network a whole bunch of trees together, kind of like you do radio telescopes. We're working out the math of how to network a whole bunch of trees. The Internet of Trees, yeah. So then just looking at a single tree, you look at a whole bunch of trees, and their collective data will probably be more informative than a single tree, right? Anyway. All right, so we should probably wrap this up. I'll take one more question from back there. All right, two more questions. Let me come back to you. Yeah.
Know if you have an outreach program to schools or community-based organizations?
So certainly to schools. We have a lot of programs for K-12 and college. Actually, I'm honored to say that heart math is used in hundreds of universities in various ways, but we have our first university-wide program. So Florida Atlantic University, they just did a press release about 2 weeks ago, is adopting heart math university-wide. So it will be taught to all 35,000 students and introduced into curriculum at all of the major colleges, the medical school, the psychology school, the education, so that's great. So. Yes?
My girlfriend's embarrassed to ask, but do you still have the glasses that you wore when Tom Shadyac came to visit?
I do, yeah.
You do?
I still have them, yes.
That's great.
Yeah, I was just going to answer Kevin's question. In terms of radioactive decay, this goes way beyond radioactive in terms of the cyclical nature, chemical reactions, other reactions. If you measure it, you think all the noise of the reaction is just noise. If you look at all the noise throughout the world, it's all coordinated. And there's some extensive studies done on that whole arena by a guy named Schnoll.
Oh, yeah.
So it's very, very interesting that the time is not what you think of as time because of these cyclical natures. And errors that you think are errors are not really errors. This ratchet goes up and goes down, up and goes down, you just average it out. So if you look at that throughout the world in different labs, and if you look at it at the same time, it does the same thing. So it's very interesting things associated with that. Well, there's other things going on in terms of...
Oh, there's no such thing as noise? Is that what you're saying?
Well,
you just have to understand
noise,
what it is, you know. Yeah. One man's noise, another man's signal.
Or cosmic background, really.
Yes.
Very quickly, is there any correlation between your charts and the stock market cycle?
Yes. Yes. Roughly, yes. There's a couple of published studies on that. One was done by some big financial institution. In fact, there's even an organization, I think it's called Cycles, that tries to sell you software that allows you to invest in the stock market, and their data actually suggests it's pretty good, you know, to do that. But I don't have enough money floating around to play in the stock market.
Yeah, so we'll have a long trip to go back to, so we should probably close it. And then if there's a few more questions on an individual basis,
let's do one more.
Okay.
I keep saying that. All right, one more. Who had the yes?
Earthquake?
Yes.
Do they have any relation with animals?
Animals.
Yeah.
Well, animals went away before they happened.
Yeah.
In fact, China still has a formal earthquake prediction system based on weird animal behavior. Animals are more tuned in than we are. I mean, they don't have all the cognitive stuff in the way. They just feel, react, and do what they're... Okay. Thank you. We'll close it up.
Appreciate it.
Very brief things for you. First of all, great talk.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.